Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship here at Bethany Lutheran Church. What a beautiful day to be in worship here together. Whether you're here on campus with us or joining us together on the live stream, we are so pleased that we have the opportunity to continue our Easter celebration here this morning as the people of God at Bethany Lutheran Church. By way of quick introduction, my name is Nate Preisinger, in case we haven't had the chance to meet yet. I serve here as one of the pastors at Bethany. Serve alongside Pastor Gary Sandberg, our pastoral intern, Rita Argus, and our director of pastoral care, Janet Mortensen. Let me say, if it's your first time joining us for worship here at Bethany, please make sure to introduce yourself to one of the pastoral staff before you leave here today. We would love the chance to connect with you and just answer any questions you might have and welcome you to Bethany. We are so pleased to see new faces in worship each and every week. Just so you know, there's a couple of little pieces I want to explain to you about our worship service before we begin. We celebrated Earth Day on Friday. You might have heard about that and seen things on the news, etc. And so just in recognition of that, we are going to have a special opening this morning that is a prayers of healing for creation. When we confess that we believe in God, the Father, creator of heaven and earth, we are stating that we have a real vested interest in the care of this world. And so we'll take part in this healing of creation. It seemed appropriate to line that up with Earth Day. Just so you know, this is all printed in your bulletin on page 3. Pastor Gary and intern Rita will sing some of these petitions, and then you'll be invited to respond with that God renew, just those three notes right there in response. I'll still have my mic on so you can follow my lead. But then after they make their way through the verses, the music will swell and we'll sing after each verse this little refrain for the healing of creation. Trust me, it'll all make sense. It's a very beautiful piece of music and a really good way for us to live out our call of believing in God the Creator. One other note for you this morning. We have these beautiful altar flowers up here on either side of me. Those were given to us by the Lutheran family. Gail Lutheran's funeral was held here this past Friday. So we continue to hold that family in our prayers, but we also give thanks for the gift of resurrection and the beautification of our sanctuary as part of that this morning. I believe those are all the pieces that I wanted you to know about here at the beginning of worship. As I said, we are continuing in our Easter celebration. But what I'll invite you to do at this moment is to just pause. It might have been a little chaotic getting here this morning. There might have been something stressful that you're carrying with you. I invite you to take a few deep breaths and to truly enter into this time of worship together this morning. We will begin with that healing of creation litany in just a short moment, but first, a time of silent prayer to prepare your hearts and minds for worship.
We join together in our call to worship. Power and might and majesty belong to God who created and is creating.
Thanks be to God for God's mighty wonders.
God is robed in light, honor, and majesty, and has laid the foundation of this universe as a mirror image of God's own unchanging nature.
We look around us at the wonders and marvel and the infinite variety and beauty which God has created.
Who are we that God should pay attention to us?
We are God's fellow children, stewards of God's heaven, heir of God's
world. Amen.
Amen.
is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Blessed are you, O God, creator of the universe. You are gracious and merciful, slow to anger and full of love. Your compassion fills your whole creation. With all your creatures, we sing your praise and look to you for life through Jesus Christ, in whom you make all things new, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to stand and join in singing our gathering hymn, Christ the Lord is risen today. Alleluia.
You may be seated, and I invite our young people to come forward for the children's sermon and off to children's church. Come on forward, anyone who's helping out with children's church as well. All right. Good job, Esme. Good morning, everyone. Don't be shy. Come on forward. Excellent. So glad to see all of you here this morning. Okay, does anyone remember what last Sunday was? What happened last Sunday? Easter, that's right. Does anyone remember the Easter story? What happens on Easter morning? Esme, do you remember? You got to find eggs, yeah, that's part of Easter, good answer. And the Easter bunny came, okay. Does anyone remember what we talked about at church? Yeah, go ahead. Anybody? Yeah, Addison, please. That's right! So, on Friday, we call it Good Friday, and Jesus dies on the cross, and then on Easter Sunday, something extraordinary happens, and Jesus rises from the tomb. The tomb is empty. So I have right here, what's this? A cross. It's pretty ordinary looking, isn't it?
The cross is up there.
And the cross is up there too. Ooh, it's got a nice white sash on it. All right, so this is just an ordinary looking cross, but you all, as part of Children's Church, are gonna really lean into this resurrection idea, right? God did something extraordinary, taking the tomb and making it empty, taking the cross and making it a sign of hope. And so you're gonna make this into an extraordinary cross as we think about this. Because it's not just that the resurrection happened, but it's that it also lives through each of us. So do you think you can make this extraordinary for me? Do you think we can do this today? I think you're gonna have a lot of fun working on it. So I'm gonna send you now with Miss Gail and Miss Bev and Mr. Brian, and you're gonna have that cross, and we'll see what you come up with later on in worship, okay? Thanks, everybody.
In God's Word for the Week this past Monday, we discussed that the book of Acts has a strong emphasis on the Holy Spirit. During this season of Easter, it invites us to consider how we can be bold in our faith. The read, which is from Acts, and I've got all this writing here. It's from Acts somewhere, Acts chapter 5, verses 27 through 32. The reading. When they had brought the apostles, they had them stand before the council. The high priest questioned them, saying, "We gave you strict orders not to teach in this name. Yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you are determined to bring this man's blood on us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than any human authority. The God of our ancestors raised up Jesus, whom you had killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior, that he might give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses to these things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey him." The word of the Lord. Please join me in singing the gospel acclamation as we rise.
John. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. And then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When he had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. But if you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to them, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe. Now, Jesus did many other things in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you may have life in his name. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. As many of you know, I have three beautiful children, ages 10, 8, and 4. And I know I knew this previously, but one of the things that I'm relearning now as a parent is that kids hate to miss out on things. Now, this can happen in all sorts of vast, expansive ways, but in our household, it will inevitably happen that my wife and I will be discussing something very boring. You know, some sort of adult matter that, frankly, we don't even really want to be talking about, but we need to. And one of our kids will jump in and interrupt and want to know what we're talking about. I'm not kidding. The last week, we were talking about our baseboards and how we needed to get those put in. And then one of our children runs up and says, "Hey, what are you talking about?" It's like, "We're talking about baseboards." Like, "Yeah, but what are you saying about them? Like, do you really want to know about this and how we're going to put them together?" But it's just a reminder. Kids hate to miss out on things. And we probably have all experienced that as well. Missing out is actually really hard. When you're around a group of people and they have some sort of inside joke and you're on the outside looking in, it's never a fun experience. Sometimes here at church, when we don't do a good job explaining things in the bulletin, you might feel like you're missing out on the joke. But I think it's just such a human tendency because there's an element of grief involved in missing out. When you miss out, it's lonely and it's isolating and it hurts. And so I tell you all this because we also are often always so quick to condemn the disciple Thomas, who we just read about. We've labeled him Doubting Thomas. What a name to carry around with you for your life. But have you ever stopped to realize how left out Thomas must have felt? His friends didn't just have an inside joke that they weren't sharing with him. They had literally seen the greatest miracle the world has ever known. They had been set free from all the terror of Good Friday and Jesus' death. They had hope and purpose again. And Thomas, he was still on the outside looking in. To help us get in touch just with this emotional space I'm talking about, I'm going to invite us to sing. Printed in your bulletin are two verses from Ah, Holy Jesus. This is a hymn that we only sing on Good Friday. I'm not kidding. It's a really good hymn, and it kind of is no fair that we only sing it once a year. So we're going to sing it today. It's in the bulletin, and as we sing it, I invite you to just notice how strange and harsh and out of place this hymn feels for us today, us people who have already experienced the Easter joy. Are you ready? All right, hit it, Rick.
Thank you.
Wasn't that weird? We've already had Easter. We've all moved on from Good Friday and the crucifixion, but that hymn, that's the emotional space where Thomas still was. He missed out, and so his grief and his terror and his despair were still all that he knew. No wonder he had doubts. Thomas was still living in a minor key. But the second half of this gospel is the truly amazing part, because Jesus comes back for Thomas. Just as the good shepherd comes back for the one lost sheep, and the widow searches her house for the one lost coin, Jesus comes back for the one disciple who had missed out. And just by showing up, Jesus is able to move Thomas into an entirely new chapter in his story. After seeing and touching Jesus' wounds, Thomas was no longer trapped in Good Friday. And that's extraordinary, and that's amazing, but when you stop and really think about it, what Jesus did for Thomas was actually incredibly ordinary. Yes, Jesus had already risen from the dead, and that is not ordinary at all, but in Thomas's case, Jesus simply shows up. And this ordinary action is able to move Thomas out of Good Friday despair and into the joy of Easter Sunday that all his friends had already experienced. We don't talk about this enough, about how God works in such ordinary ways sometimes. It's not always the big, fancy, showing amazing moments. A lot of the time, we just have some sort of small, ordinary encounter with Jesus that completely changes things. Author Richard Rohr says, "Christ comes to you disguised as your life." It's true. There are so many ordinary moments, so many small encounters where God taps us on the shoulder and it changes everything. I myself have been through a number of difficult times throughout my life, and I'm always amazed how more often than not, it's my kids bursting in and saying something simple and yet profound and beautiful, and it helps me completely reframe the dark, sorrowful moment I found myself in. But this is how God so often works. We're invited to see the power of the resurrection every single day, not just on Easter Sunday, not just when something truly miraculous happens, but every day we're invited to realize that the ordinary moments of life can actually contain the very presence and power of the risen Christ. And just like Thomas, our lives can be changed. The song can be altered from sorrow to joy by the simple and yet extraordinary ways that Christ breaks in. When we learn to live like this, we discover more hope and joy and wonder. Your ears become tuned to the workings of God all around you, all throughout your daily life. And you'll be more equipped to see the small, ordinary ways that you can practice the resurrection. The ways that you can bring new life and new hope and extraordinary possibilities to the people that God places along your path. To illustrate this point, we're going to sing another hymn. It's in your bulletin. It's the hymn of the day. And the words are from an Easter hymn. But the music is actually something a little different. Our director of music, Rick Seaton, has put this together. It's the same tune as Ah, Holy Jesus that we sang earlier. But Rick just shifted things a little bit into a major key. It's a reminder to us that simple little changes can make a world of difference. And more to the point, it's a reminder that God can take something like Good Friday and turn it into something joyful and beautiful. But we're actually also going to take this all a step further. This is an interactive sermon, in case you haven't realized yet. You're going to be invited, if you want to, while we're singing this hymn, to come forward. My assistants have helped and set this up for me. We have a tree here. Oftentimes we refer to the cross as the tree where Christ was hung. And what we're going to do is we're going to take this ordinary tree that might remind us of Good Friday and have the opportunity, through a small, simple action, to turn it into something beautiful as well. There are stickers in that basket right there, and at any point during this hymn, feel free to come forward and just add your one sticker to the tree. It'll be one small little action, but it's a reminder that we can embody this belief as the people of God. That one small little action, when all done collectively, can really have life-changing differences for the world around us. Something ordinary can become extraordinary when we, as people of faith, embody this belief that ordinary actions really can change the world in meaningful ways. You're invited to sing, you're invited to stay where you are, but let this all be a reminder of this Easter promise. As you know, our young people are also working on their own art project, and somewhere in the weeks ahead, I'll set these up throughout the worship space so that you can see them and have them as this continual reminder that our Christian faith is based on the belief that God took the tree of the cross and made it beautiful and holy. And so we are called to take ordinary actions to heal this world and to bring hope to despair each and every day. I invite you to stand, I invite you to come forward, I invite you to join me in singing this major key of Ah, Holy Jesus with the words of Rise, Shine, You People. So it was, you literally put a sticker on a poster board. An ordinary action can become something so incredibly beautiful. And it's a reminder to us that this is how God works for us, showing up in ordinary ways to do something extraordinary, and that this is our call too, to take ordinary action to bring that resurrection hope to people in the most small and yet most significant of ways. And so to further live in to this promise of resurrection, this way that something ordinary can do something extraordinary, we turn now to a time of baptism. It's printed in your program right there. We're going to have the baptism of Riker right now. I'll invite the family to come forward and turn your attention to the font. Friends, we gather at these living waters. Throughout history, God's saving action towards God's people has taken place through water. Let us pray. Most holy God, you created the seas, rivers, and lakes. You saved Noah and his family from the floods. You led the Israelites through the Red Sea and quenched their thirst with water flowing from a rock. Through the waters of the Jordan River, you proclaimed Jesus, your own beloved Son. So through these waters of baptism, you proclaim that we too are your own beloved children, now and forever. Amen. Parents, I ask you, do you wish Riker to be baptized into the promises of God? If so, respond, we do.
We do.
We make promises and assume responsibilities at baptism. God promises us unconditional love and life forever. And we know that our journey of faith encompasses certain promises so that our lives reflect this love. Parents, do you promise to live with your child among God's faithful people, to bring your child to the Lord's table, to teach them the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place the Holy Scriptures in their hands, to nurture their faith and prayer life so that they will know and trust God?
We do.
Parents, sponsors, and you, people of God, do you promise to support and pray for Riker's new life in Christ?
We do.
I'm going to invite you to hold Riker over the front. Make it easy if he's on his back.
Yep, that'll work.
Here, can I hold you? I got you right here.
Riker Maddox, child of God, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Hairdo on that one, too.
Hang on to that if you need them.
Come in here just a minute.
Yes.
Holy God, sustain Riker with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen. Oil has been used throughout the centuries to anoint kings and prophets into God's service. We now use oil to anoint Riker into his life of service to God. And we say, Riker Maddox, child of God, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Pastor Nate will hand the family a candle. Fire has often been a symbol of the presence of God, particularly the Holy Spirit, as it shines in our lives. And now we ask for that Spirit to shine in and through Riker's life. And so we say, let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify your Father in heaven. Yeah. Will you all come with me? I'm going to come introduce you. Friends, this is Riker, your new sibling in Christ, whom you have just promised that you would be a part of this family in caring for him and in bringing the joy that he brings to you, that you will share back the very love of God in this place. I invite you to join me in the words of welcome, and then we'll have an applause of welcome. Let us welcome our new sibling in Christ. We welcome you into the Lord's family. We receive you as a member of the body of Christ. child of God's kingdom on earth and in heaven. Will you join me in welcoming him? I invite you to stand. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Please share a sign of God's peace with those who are near you.
Good morning, everyone. We now turn to some brief announcements in a time that we like to call Abundantly Bethany. While I get started, if you are a confirmation mentor, if you could start making your way towards the front, Brian has some acknowledgments to do for you. So we'll do that so we can keep this brief. A quick note for today, during community time, there is going to be a food breakdown. If you've never participated in one of those before, just stop by. There's plenty of people who have done them before, and they will be able to help you along the way. And then a quick note of something to put on your calendar for next week. Pastor Simon Hammer from Estonia will be here and will be doing an extended conversation in the chapel after during community time at 11:15. So if you are interested in participating in that, then you are welcome to attend. And one other announcement for something to put on your calendar for next week.
Hi guys, I'm Adam and I'm a confirmation student, and for my confirmation project, I'm going to be having a bake sale to support victims of domestic violence. All proceeds will be going to the Safe House of Denver. The bake sale will be next Sunday in the Fellowship Hall, so come have some treats. Also, after this service, we will have a sign-up sheet outside if you want to help contribute by bringing a baked good. Thank you.
You can give it to Brian. And now Brian has a quick announcement.
All right, mentors and mentees, come across so the whole church can see you. Let's come in front of the beautiful tree here. Come on over, come on over. So we said at the beginning of Lent, faith is made whole in community. We had a baptism over here, baptism of Riker. Faith is made whole in community. All of us who are baptized in Christ need one another, and we have some mentors and mentees, I feel like I'm saying manatee, but it's mentees, right, who have celebrated a time of becoming made whole in community, encountering prayer stations, getting to know one another, because we cannot follow Jesus alone. We can't practice resurrection alone. Faith is always made whole in community. So hopefully mentors have gotten a thank you card and an ice cream gift certificate from their mentee. If not, we'll get it later. Right now, we're going to bless them. So just raise your hands and blessing. We bless these relationships that we want to sustain and keep. Let us pray. Thank you, God, for all these mentors and for the confirmation students. Bless those who are here. Bless those who aren't here today. Strengthen us for service that we might be made whole and practice resurrection together. And all God's people say, amen. Let's thank them. Thank you.
And afterwards, during
a food breakdown, there's going to be an ice cream party, kickball and stuff. If you want to join it, if you've not read the food breakdown for you, you can join us too. We hope to see you either way. Peace.
All of these programs are made possible by your generous offering. All the ways that you can give are listed on page 8 in your bulletin. Or if there's another God-pleasing ministry that you support as we move into this time of offering, into this space of worship, you're welcome to pull out your smartphone and do that. So as we move it, like create space for this act of worship, we will hear an offertory anthem from our bluegrass band.
Thank you.
that mountain. Sometimes you slip, sometimes you fall, and those boulders come a-crashing. You get trapped, lonely and lost, and you're laying in that valley,
and you think,
no one cares,
no one cares.
I know someone,
I know someone.
Roll that rock away, roll that rock away, roll that rock away. Jesus is his name, and he'll roll that rock away. Gather around you and the wind begins to blow.
Come on, sister.
You're still stuck down in that valley beneath the rain,
the mud and stones.
And you feel like there's no tomorrow. And all your hope is gone.
Hope is gone.
Just cry. And they hung him on the cross. When the time came, it was finished. He shed his blood for all the lost. Then they laid him in a tomb, and they blocked the door with stone. And 3 days later, Mary came to see him.
She cried,
into a spirit of prayer. God, who makes ordinary into extraordinary, do a new thing in the church. Pour out your spirit on this community so that we might be inspired to live into the gospel. Give us courage to follow you on our journey of faith. Holy God, receive our prayer. Do a new thing for creation. Pour out your spirit onto all creation so that new life may spring forth from the old. Revive habitats that have been impaired by human disregard and protect environments that are the most vulnerable. Merciful God, receive our prayer. Do a new thing in our world. Break barriers that prevent people from working together for the well-being of all. Make a way for peace and collaboration among the nations. Gracious God, receive our prayer. Do a new thing for those who suffer. Reveal a path for any who are unemployed or underemployed, for those experiencing homelessness, and for all who struggle with money. Be with those in our community most in need. Barbara, Lee, Ian, John, Mark, Dan, Kathy, Zoe and parents, Cooper, and Zachary. God, we also ask that you comfort those in our community who grieve. Tony at the death of his cousin Linda, Paula at the death of her son Sam. Give them peace and hope in the resurrection. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of the world in need for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. And at this time, we welcome our children back from Children's Church with their extraordinary cross.
Children enter the sanctuary at this point as a way for us to recognize the invitation to Holy Communion. And please know that if you are in the worship space this day, if you are gathered online, you're invited to celebrate communion as a part of the worship life of Bethany Lutheran Church. But please know, this is not an invitation from me. This is not an invitation from Bethany Lutheran Church. This is an invitation from Jesus Christ. Jesus provides us with these gifts of bread and wine, his body and blood. It is by his invitation that all are gathered to celebrate communion here. Note, we have a special communion liturgy dialogue to open our time together. You'll find that at the middle of page 8 in your worship bulletin. I invite you to stand. Just as grains of wheat are gathered together to become one bread, the Holy Spirit has gathered us together this day. Though we are ordinary people, we know that through this meal, something extraordinary happens, and we are fed with spiritual food. Let us join our voices as one now in the great thanksgiving. In this meal, we remember Christ's sacrifice. His arms stretched out for all. In this meal, the hope and grace of God is revealed. A mission of love and sacrifice for one another. In this meal, ordinary bread and ordinary wine become the presence of Jesus Christ. For it was in an upper room in Jerusalem where Jesus was gathered with his disciples to share in the Passover meal that would turn out to be the last Passover meal that Jesus would share with his disciples, as this would become the night of his betrayal. It was in that meal that our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." As we are gathered into one by the power of the Spirit, we now join our voices as one, praying as Jesus has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Note that there are printed instructions about how communion will be distributed this morning. Just briefly, as you come forward, you'll receive a prepackaged kit that includes both bread and grape juice as a part of that kit. We invite you to receive that and then take it back to your seat. Open up the top layer to reveal the bread. The second layer will reveal the juice, thereby receiving the body and blood of Christ back in your seat. If you desire gluten-free bread, simply let your server know. We have a few of those prepackaged kits that have gluten-free bread in them on every tray. You'll be provided with one of them. Come, taste and see. The Lord is good.
Is knowing you need
I invite you to stand. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. Amen.
Before I offer the benediction, I wanted to congratulate all of you because you each won the door prize this morning. Before you exit, you can feel free to take any of the Easter flowers home with you. You can just come on up after our closing hymn and take that home with you to bless your space at home. And now, receive the day's blessing. As you go on your way, may God go with you. May God go before you to show you the way, above you to watch over you, beside you to be your friend, and may God be within you to give you peace, this day and always, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We join in singing our ascending hymn. It's on page 10 in your bulletin. Serve the Lord.